Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Saida Kisai Zehra and I'm Program Officer, Research Associate at South Asia Research Institute for Minorities. This organization is a leading provider of minority rights. Just a little housekeeping before we get started. If you have any question during the webinar, kindly inbox. I will bring them up at the end of the session. Today we are presenting the topic, the collective social responsibilities of South Asian minorities in coping with COVID-19. Before we get started, I would like to present a presentation on the current topic. So I would like to share the screen. Okay, so you can see the increasing COVID cases of South Asian countries that are mentioned. Have a look on India and Pakistan, the most affected because of COVID-19. Okay, so you know that increasing COVID cases in South Asian countries, many people suffered, like minorities suffer the most, because why they are suffered? Basically, this is the question, why they are suffered. And they suffered because they don't get admission in the hospitals, or they are dying because nobody cares. This is still unanswered. So you can see the countries affected by the COVID-19, Nepal and India, the situation is out of control as they are running out of bed and oxygen. You can see in different region also. Meanwhile, minorities being responsible and helping, you can see this positive in the whole of COVID world. Next. Thank you so much for your time and patience. Now, without further addition, we will turn the time over to the speakers. Our first speaker is Dr. Sardesha Priya Vijitunge, Ambassador of Peace Director General, Sunfro Global Federation from Sri Lanka. We are delighted to have you, sir. May you proceed now.
Aibowan, Namaste, Assalamu Alaikum. And I am very happy to join this international webinar, the South Asian Minorities, Collective Social Responsibilities in Coping with COVID-19 Situation. In South Asia, almost all countries now suffering heavily with the third wave of the COVID-19. I am from Sri Lanka, but including Sri Lanka, the situation getting worse day by day with the increasing number of patients. It's almost coming to the point of unbearable to the present health facilities and the capacity. Also, we hear the India, the situation in Nepal, and other countries also getting worse day by day. So today in this minority, I wish to focus a specific group of the indigenous and tribal people in South Asia. I know these learned speakers will speak different aspects as per the topic. So, but I want to focus especially this indigenous people situation with this COVID-19 pandemic today in South Asia. Indigenous people constitute a substantial part of South Asian population. Indigenous people experience a high degree of socio-economic marginalization and are at disproportionate risk in public health. Emergencies care becoming even more vulnerable during this global pandemic, owing to factors such as their lack of access to effective monitoring and early warning systems and adequate health and social services. Yet, indigenous people are seeking their own solutions to the pandemic. They are taking actions and using traditional knowledge and practices such as voluntary isolation and sealing of their territories, as well as preventive measures in their own languages and historically what they have been used for generations. But the COVID-19 pandemic and its social and economic consequences are dramatically altering the trajectory towards achieving the Sustainable Development Goals, SDG Agenda 2032. While the world leaders were agreeing and declaring SDG Agenda on 25th September 2015 at the UN headquarters to be achieved by 31st of December 2030, never assumed, never considered, or never dreamed this type of pandemic will come in the world during this SDG era. So the millions of indigenous and tribal peoples, a combination of century-old marginalization and a set of distinct social, economic, health, and environmental vulnerabilities in the COVID-19 context, exposing these indigenous peoples to particularly serve impact of the current crisis in very bad way, even though all of us and others experiences. Really, we have 7 key indigenous tribes from South Asia historically identified as well as presently existing. Veddas, the forest people of Veddas are the indigenous people in Sri Lanka. The third corona wave in Sri Lanka heavily affected lifestyle and sustainability of Veddas. Jarawa, one of the Adivasi indigenous peoples of the Andaman Islands in India. Jarawas are considered to be one of the most isolated natives in the world. So this minority people, how they face this pandemic is not in a good situation. Kalash, the Indo-Aryan indigenous people of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province in Pakistan, can easily be clubbed under the country's smallest religion. A unique group, the Kalash people are polytheists who lay emphasis on nature and offer sacrifices as a part of their culture. Their methodology and folklore has been compared by researchers to that of ancient Greece, but are closer to Indo-Iranian traditions today. They also have their own distinct language of communication. So have to see about how they face this pandemic as a minority group. Fourthly, Loho, a small tribe of southwest Bhutan. The Loh, or also they called as Doya people, and they trace their descent, material heredity, and marry their cross cousins. So their immunity system also questionable. Only 2,500 in number, the tribe speaks Tibeto-Burmese language while living in Bhutan. Bodo, we may hear indigenous people of Nepal and northeastern India too. Bodos are a silkworm rearing tribe. All families have their own silkworms, and girls learn how to spin silk at a young age. Weaving also forms of an integral part of their culture. So the Girawaru is the minority indigenous people. They are native to Girawari Island in Maldives. The same name tribe were essentially those considered to be of lower caste than the others in Maldives. Consequently, due to isolation with this pandemic, they developed a series of heritage genetic disorders too. The Naga, a collection of several tribes, Nagas are native to northeastern India and northern western Myanmar too. They speak some 89 distinct languages for their communication. All parts of Tibeto-Burmian family. We identified several smaller indigenous communities too in South Asia, in addition to these seven main tribes I explained. So let us think about what happened to this minority indigenous people in South Asia with this pandemic. Indigenous peoples' traditional lifestyles are a source of their resiliency and can also pose a threat at their time of preventing the spread of the virus. For example, most indigenous communities regularly organize large traditional gatherings to mark special events. It's a harvest, coming of age, ceremonies, and many other. Some indigenous communities live in multi-generational housing. Even the 3-4 generations are living in the same house or the residence, which puts indigenous peoples are their families, especially the elders who are in together, are in grave risk. As the number of COVID-19 infections rises worldwide, rises in South Asia, as well as the high mortality rates among certain vulnerable groups with underlying health conditions, data on the rate of infection of indigenous people are either not yet available or not in the correct numbers. Even we are reporting and testing are available in some parts, but not for all, or not recorded by ethnicity. They might be recorded with as mixed with other groups. Relevant information about infectious diseases and preventive measures is also not available in indigenous languages as they understand. So the lack of proper knowledge, information, transformation is presently we feel. As lockdowns continues in numerous countries in South Asia with no timeline in sight, indigenous peoples who already face food insecurity as a result of the loss of their traditional lands and territories and jungles confront even grave challenges in access of their basic food. With the loss of their traditional livelihoods, which are often land-based, many indigenous peoples who work in traditional occupations and subsistence economies or in the informal sector will be adversely affected by the pandemic. The situation is very pathetic, especially indigenous women who are often the main providers of food and nutrition to their families is even a graver situation. The coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic poses a grave health threat, specifically to indigenous people in South Asia as well as around the world. Indigenous communities already experience poor access to healthcare, as we are aware, significantly higher rates of communicable and non-communicable diseases too, lack of access to essential services, sanitation, and other key preventive measures such as clean water, soap, disinfectants, etc., etc. Likewise, most nearby local medical facilities, if and when there are any, are often under-equipped and understaffed. Even when indigenous people are able to access healthcare services remotely, they can face stigma and discrimination in those centers. A key factor is to ensure these services and facilities are provided in indigenous languages and as appropriate to the specific situation of indigenous peoples what they face. With this above analysis, the vulnerabilities of indigenous and tribal peoples in the COVID-19 context and identifies urgent and continuing actions to ensure their access to good health and social protection. As part of the unfolding COVID-19 responses and recovery, highlighting the importance of social dialogue for advancing solutions. The brief also underlines that state institutions in South Asian governments for indigenous and tribal peoples, participation and consultations are essential for building pathways to resilience and sustainable development that leave no one behind as planned. Of course, the COVID-19 socio-economic consequences have a profound impact on indigenous and tribal working class, entrepreneurs, and communities. Action to ensure a COVID-19 response and recovery that is responsive to indigenous and tribal people's needs must advance their lifestyle and social protection, promoting green jobs that contribute to resilience and sustainable enterprises and livelihoods is a key strategy in this regard. Actions must start now, but we'll need to continue in a sustainable manner with social dialogues as an indispensable tool for advancing solutions. Though national context and circumstances, including the size and diversity of indigenous people, vary, common entry points and areas of action that should be considered include the following: meeting urgent protection needs by the authorities. Together with these indigenous peoples' representatives, there are whatever available institutions, there are available social movements protecting indigenous rights to develop and discriminate curtly appropriate information in indigenous languages for preventing the spread of COVID-19, including information accessible for persons with disabilities. Support prevention measures taken by indigenous peoples themselves based on their cultures and traditions came in their generations, such as community closures, very common now with indigenous population. In coordination with the state preventive measures of South Asian governments and taking actions against unauthorized intrusions upon indigenous people's lands or territories, undertake rapid assessments of their economic impact of COVID-19 on indigenous women and men, children in the informal economy, both workers and entrepreneurs. Also for developing support measures, targeting sectors and occupations in the which indigenous women and men are engaged, or certain geographical areas. Also, further, indigenous people, ensure that measures taken no enhance the availability, accessibility, acceptability, and quality of health services also benefit indigenous people are culturally appropriate and ensure effective access to health care, including COVID-19 testing, vaccination, and other supportive treatments. Also, while sharing these thoughts, let me thank sincerely the South Asian Research Institute for Minorities and their institution officials, and all learned speakers sharing their views today in different angles and prospects, focusing the segments of the minority in the South Asia. So I wish all the best for this international webinar, is what is in the timely need. Thank you all. Have a good program, good workshop, and good day.
Thank you so much, sir. It's been an honor to have you. Moving to another speaker from India, Dr. Sojanya, Assistant Professor, School of Gender Studies, Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Thank you, ma'am, for your time. May you proceed now.
So I would like to specifically present on the scenario in India. So India is the second most unequal country in the world, with large disparities in the land holdings, wealth, and other resources of the country. 1% of its population belongs to the upper tiers, holds 90% of the overall wealth of the nation. Whereas 1% of the wealth, of its overall wealth, is all what is there in the hands of 90% of the population. So for such a society, pandemic is an unimaginable situation that the state cannot take the total control and hold over. With an authoritarian government at the center, and elections being around in many states in India, the state and even the respective state governments have only revealed a very skewed numbers of death toll and tested positive cases. And there has been a severe paucity for test kits, beds, oxygen cylinders, and vaccination as well. So not only the center being, also diverted a lot of vaccinations to the most powerful capitalist countries of the globe, compromising on the security, health, and well-being of its people. Coming to the specificities of the pandemic, the first wave is marked by the sudden lockdown in March 2000. That left the question of migrant laborers unanswered. People who were migrant laborers to the most of the cities, the urban cities in the country, have walked back to the place, to their respective villages, where people died on the roads of starvation and exhaustion, though the government had not revealed any numbers, a number of deaths of the migrant laborers. It was considered the second largest migration ever since the partition of India and Pakistan. The second wave, which is the current one, is marked by the unprecedented death toll with only partial curfews in urban and semi-urban places. Death toll is much higher than the first one, and there is alarming paucity of oxygen cylinders, beds in the hospitals, while the affluent people and the ministers are securing rooms in the prestigious hospitals and seven-star hotels in anticipation of their falling sick of COVID-19. During the lockdown, there has been also hate speeches against Muslims with regard to the Tablighi Jamaat that was held in Delhi before the lockdown. And there have been unreported cases of violence against minorities. And hospitals being communally divided in most of the cities have rejected the minorities admission into the hospitals. So the first important community, the important largest community that has been affected during the pandemic, also because of the prejudices and the Sangh Parivars. Propagation of prejudice against Muslims being the reason for the increase of pandemic in the first wave. And there has also been a sudden surge in the atrocities and violence against Dalits during the lockdown. And Coimbatore based advocate N. Paneerselvan claimed that 50 cases of killing, rape, and physical attacks against Dalits have been reported within the lockdown of 2 months, period in whole of Tamil Nadu. And the untouchability was also justified ideologically by the Orthodox Brahmin community. The Brahmin orthodoxy claimed that the untouchability invented by the Vedic religion has become the resort for the people in the pandemic of COVID-19. And caste is not class, but class is one of the aspects of caste system in India. For instance, the lower classes in India are also lower castes, while the Brahmin and the dominant caste are well placed on the scale of class and the economic prosperity and the possibility of economic upward mobility. The Dalits and the lower caste had to bear the brunt of lockdown, food insecurity, and lack of medical facilitation during the pandemic. So the second being the largest minority or the vulnerable minority of Dalits were the second community that has fallen prey to the pandemic and as well as the state's negligence towards them and their food security and the medical security. So another community that faced severe paucity of the basic amenities was the trans women community during the first lockdown. So trans women community do not like, you know, the pre-pandemic situation has been in India the case of who is a citizen and the CAA protests in Delhi, centered in Delhi, but all over the country. So some of the minorities, apart from Muslims, Christians, and Dalits, who also became the victims of CAA in India was the trans women community, because trans women community do not register in any of the state's bodies because of the fear of the state violence and the police brutality against them. During the lockdown, only those who had ration cards were supplied groceries and the groceries and the medical kit. But trans women not holding any of the ration cards and also not considered to be the migrant laborers because much of their labor was either beggary or the sex work, which is not considered to be a labor. So most of them fallen prey to the food insecurity during that lockdown. And trans women also, the community suffered not only the severe food insecurity, but they also failed to get antiretroviral drugs because most of them were HIV patients, as they rely on sex work being one of the sources of livelihoods, while the beggary being the other. So the entire pandemic situation is not only a blow, not only proved to be proved to be alarming for all these minority communities, but there also have been the communities which may not be necessarily minority communities in that sense. For instance, women in the families of all kinds of families, be it the upper class, upper caste, or the lower class women who were locked up in the houses, faced severe brutal violence, domestic violence, where the state intervention was much lesser compared to any other form of violence. Though women are though they are not minorities, but they are also vulnerable to the violence. But so here is here are the pictures of like very non-state oriented pictures, where state is not ready to reveal the numbers of women who died in the families, or the minorities who died in the communal violence, or Dalits who died in the caste atrocities. Okay, so therefore, like, the kind of picture that the state wanted to show to the entire world, because it doesn't want to show a failed picture of unable to precedent the whole situation, is leading to covering of all these atrocities, all the kind of violences, that the violence, forms of violence that were committed against the both the minority community and the vulnerable communities. So therefore, it is now it is on the shoulders, onus lies on the shoulders of those social activists, academics, and NGOs, and the individuals, and the people who are running the movements, people's movements, are the people now to responsibly respond to the atrocities, respond to the violence, because now the state has almost washed its hands off because it always wanted to show up as some state which is not failed in the on the face of the global politics. Okay, so with this, I thank the organizers for inviting me.
Thank you. Now moving to another speaker, Dr. Chandriya Gopani, Assistant Professor, GP Pan Social Sciences Institute from India. I'm glad to have you, sir. Over to you. Thank you.
So good afternoon to everyone. I thank South Asia Research Institute for Minorities. I remember last time also I participated on the role of social media in protecting the minority communities' rights. So I'm happy to see all with the co-panelists. I'm nothing to say a new thing, because Saujanya, she's very, very active, and she summarized the overall picture of India's situation. So many dimensions she touched upon. So I just, in one way, I try to repeat certain things which are need to be emphasized, and then I will finish. Because in India, when we talk about minorities, minorities in terms of religious minorities, like Sikhs, Muslims, Christians, and there are variety of groups. Minorities in terms of social minorities, like Dalits, other groups, so who are, more than 17% of the total population. So we have to understand minority in a, diverse way. So in India, of course, in South Asia, I feel that if you don't understand the caste, you don't understand the Indian reality, in specific, in South Asia reality also, whether it is in Pakistan, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, even Nepal. So caste become one of the very, very important and foundational structural issue that determines our everyday relationship, our class, lifestyles, all institutions, functions, and so on and so forth. So in this pandemic situation in India, first wave was really, you know, because in first wave, though there was crisis, generally people, the cases were not reported much. Cases compared to this second wave, cases were less, and there was a fear, and there was a kind of migration problem that was exposed the structural issues of the Indian societies. But the second wave, if you see the situation, people are begin to say that system is collapsed, institutions are collapsed, health sector is collapsed. But I would say that system is already collapsed, not only in this pandemic situation, because there is a accumulated problems that are visible now in this pandemic situation. Because when was the health sector was good in India? Because now we are realizing, experiencing that, particularly elite people are experiencing that. Because elite, when problems reach the elite, then they think that system is collapsed. Because system is already collapsed. System is already collapsed for years. You have, elite has not experienced. Now elite is experiencing in cities, metropolitan cities, in small towns. Now they are experiencing how the situation is. So that's where we have to understand the Indian structural problems. See, for example, how Indian ruling class thinks and takes granted the common people. So you have elections, by knowing everything that there is a big crisis, but still they went to the elections, the rallies that they conducted in all this, in some of the states, and the kind of religious festivals like Kumbh Mela that they have organized really shows how they think about common people. So what kind of goals they have to achieve. So by knowing everything that there is a, there is going to be a, big crisis, they went, and now we are experiencing the crisis. So now, because last time, Saujana rightly pointed out, when Muslims gathered in Delhi and every media house and everybody was really attacking. And when I, I went to market, vegetable market, in one of the, center, a common man accusing a Muslim woman when she was buying vegetables, saying that, look, your people gathered in Delhi and you are the cause for the entire problem. That was the situation 1 year back. Now the situation is more than worse. And who will question this? So this is the kind of general psyche that is percolated, which is very pervasive. So now in the beginning, she, in her presentation, she rightly pointed out some of the minority communities like Muslim, not all Muslims, I would say that, not all Muslim, some Muslim groups. I remember in Telugu region, some Muslim groups, they are taking vehicle to cremate the dead bodies. Now dead bodies are throwing, nobody is carrying the dead bodies. And at least some Muslim groups taking those dead bodies and without fear, and they are burning the dead bodies. And more than thousands of the dead bodies they are burning, and they feel that this is at last stage of human life, at least one has to be respected. And some Sikh communities in Delhi, I think 2-3 days back, they opened a hospital where people can go without spending any money and get treatment. I'm just trying to bring to some examples how communities are working. But look, caste again plays a bigger role. Because whether it is in within the Christianity, within the even Muslim community, even Sikh communities, Dalits become a worst victims. And they are not accessible to the all the hospitals. Though now in hospitals, you don't get oxygen, you don't get bed, you don't get treatment. And look at those who got the oxygen and bed in hospital, majority of them, they got through recommendations. So Dalits are not accessible to those recommendations. It is very hard. So either they have to die or they will suffer like anything. So within the Dalits, women problem is worst. Old age people, I think old age people, people in the rural area, some of it, because in rural area also now people are dying, because last time there was less cases in this second wave, people are dying. And even some of the youth, they are really, really, facing a crisis. I remember in Telugu regions, during this pandemic, because for almost for 1 year, employment became a big problem. And the private teachers who lost their job, they are committing suicides. And most of the private teachers who worked in schools and colleges and small informal works, they are all come from the very marginalized communities like OBCs, Dalits, and some of the Adivasi communities, poor people. They don't have anything and they are committing suicides. I remember in Telugu region, a wife and husband, they committed suicides. They have 2 children at the age of 5-6. And look at the kind of situation that we are experiencing. And the civil societal groups, their capacity to serve the victims is very, very less. However, there are some groups who are reaching with medicines, and some people, again, some communities are arranging community-wise, caste-wise shelters. So look at, Saujanya was rightly pointing out that in Telugu region, some Brahmins were justifying the untouchability. See, in this crisis of humanity, people are justifying the caste system and untouchability. That shows how deeply they are into the hierarchical society that reflects their everyday life. So what I'm trying to bring to your attention is, crisis is, everybody is victim of the crisis, but still we have to see how certain groups are more vulnerable in this crisis. And now central government they do not have any plan, neither they have any thing that they can offer to the states. In fact, whatever foreign aid that they are getting, there is no transparency in distributing to the other states. And wherever central government BJP is in ruling, they are trying to distribute more. And wherever they are not in ruling, so they are neglecting. So this is the kind of politics that operates during this pandemic, that we should also try to see how it is working. And what is happening in Bengal, West Bengal, you would also clearly see what kind of political objectives state governments having. So however, there is a need of urgent need of vaccination with free of cost, because now central government is saying there will be a cost. I think that shows a poor man who do not have any work, who do not have anything to spend for their food, how they can spend money for their treatment, a vaccination. And many of them, they are facing a problem. So every state has to think about free vaccination with urgency and with the medical facilities and civil society. Rich people now, they are claimed that they are rich in the world, but now look at some of the rich people, the Reliance and other people, what kind of response that they are performing in this crisis. But still, there is a nexus between state and government and the capitalist. Capitalist is a Brahmanical Baniya capitalist. We have to specify when we say capitalist, who are they in each country? If it is Pakistan, which community they are? Just saying capitalist doesn't mean anything. Unless you specify their caste, social location. In India, it's a Brahmanical Baniya capitalist that they are nexused with the government and state institutions, that seriously they are, collapse the system. And that's where some of the big industries which are served to the public, now they are selling. That's where the entire crisis of oxygen clearly indicate. So with this, I stop here. Although I was very sporadic, but I was just started to emphasize some issues. And thanks for organizing this. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for your informative answer. Now move to another speaker from India, Muhammad Asif Khan. He is an Indian Muslim activist and social politics commentator. I deeply appreciate your presence today. Thank you for joining us again. Over to you.
First of all, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for inviting me again and providing me a platform to express my thoughts here. The topic was the contribution of a minority, how to cope this COVID situation. Well, right now India is going through a worst phase of this pandemic. We hit by second wave of the pandemic, and every Indian, irrespective of their religion or their caste or their gender, suffering because the government has been proven incompetent. Because of the incompetency of the government, the entire system has been collapsed and everyone is suffering. The problem is right now that government do not have any kind of plan to implement on the ground, because maybe they never expected such kind of things. Everyone, those people who are expert, they have been warned them in advance that please be prepared for second wave in the country. But government was busy in some election campaign and all kind of things. So they were busy for making their mansions and the palace, the new Central Vista project in India. So when we are hit by right now, we have more than 4 lakh cases per day reported. I'm not saying there's an actual figure, because they are fudging data. They are clearly manipulating the data. Actual numbers are, I would say, 10 times more. They are saying that 3,000, 4,000 death per day. But that's the reported cases. If you visit crematoriums and graveyards in India, then you would see the actual numbers is 10, 15 times higher than what they reported actually. So let's come to the point of the minorities and all the things. So I have 3 points regarding that. What minority doing or what can they do to cope the situation? What kind of problem they have faced during the pandemic? And most important, what is the role of majority? So I would start with the contribution of minority in India. I would talk from the perspective of Indian minority. So we have seen that last year when India was hit by the first wave of the pandemic in March 2020, and government suddenly announced strict nationwide lockdown on 24th of March. That time India has gone through the largest section of the migrant laborers had to migrate from their cities like metro cities. They were working in Bangalore, Mumbai, and Delhi and other metro cities of the India. They had to walk for miles, for 100 miles, for 1,000 miles to reach out to their home state, because government had no plan. They suddenly announced, okay, we will impose the nationwide lockdown from 12 midnight. And they have never thought about the poor people. Who were the migrant laborers? Of course, they were the people who belong to the lower caste and lower class of the society. They had no means. They are the daily wage workers who have to work every day to earn their bread and butter. So when they were stuck in metro cities without job, they have no option. They have to reach out to their home state, their village at least, so they can stay with their family. But the problem is that means of transportation was not available at that time. So they had to walk. And because of that, hundreds of migrants died because of starvation and because of road accident or train accident, and so many things happened. During that time, we seen that Muslims were also facing another kind of problem. At the same time, they were being targeted by state politicians, those people who are close to politicians, and especially, I would like to say the role of national media cannot be ignored. They were those who deliberately ran a propaganda against the Muslims. And Muslims were solely blamed for this pandemic. They were called Corona Jihadi, Corona Bomb, and they were accused of spreading bioterrorism in the country. So Muslims have been facing such kind of things. So many cases were filed against the member of the Tablighi Jamaat, and Muslims have faced violence on the street because of that propaganda. It had a dire consequences when Muslims were being lynched on the street, and poor vegetable vendors and fruit vendors, they were physically attacked. They were accused of spitting into the vegetables, and they were saying, you are deliberately spitting, you are mixing your saliva into vegetables and fruits so that you can kill Hindus. That's what Muslims faced last year. Despite that, despite all kind of humiliation, vilification, when migrant laborers were walking on the road in the month of Ramadan last year, the Muslim community has set up so many small the food center, or they were distributing food or fruits, or they were helping them in whatever capacity they can do. And they have done last year. Six were on the road, Muslim were on the road, and they were helping them. Even this year, when we are hit by the worst second wave pandemic, and this year is different actually. The last year's problem was about just food and water. People were not dying because of the lack of oxygen and the lack of the hospital beds, ICU bed, ventilator. People were just demanding either just the means of transportation or the food and water. So this supplying the basic amenities like food and water, common men can arrange it. And we did. The citizen of India have done their best to provide. Government have done nothing, although I accept that, but citizens of India have provided them food and water, and they did their best to help migrant laborers. But this time situation is different. We need medicine, we need oxygen, we need ICU beds and ventilator. Common men cannot provide them. It is the job of the states only, and state is busy in somewhere else. But as a minority, if I see, we have seen so many Sikh Muslims and even Hindus as well, they have converted their religious places into COVID care center. There are Gurudwara which have converted themselves into COVID care center. There are so many mosques across the country. They have converted themselves into COVID care center right now. They are providing basic medical assistance to the people. And there are so many stories in India right now. We have seen that people who have abandoned their dead family members, like if someone died due to the COVID, people are afraid, they are scared to go near to, they are afraid that they cannot touch the dead body. So now who are performing their funeral? There are so many cases where Muslims have been volunteering into the cremation ground, and they are performing the last rites of the dead bodies. In Maharashtra, I have shared a few days ago, in Maharashtra, four Muslim people who have been working since the beginning of the pandemic have cremated more than 800 bodies of the Hindus in last 1 year. So this is what minority is doing. And I think irrespective of your religious or caste status, as a society, what we can do to cope with the COVID-19 is that stressive. This is the only thing we can do right now. Like, we need to be more aware. Unfortunately, I have seen still many people roaming on the street and they do not know how to wear masks. They wear their mask either here or either here. Their nose is not covered, mouth is not covered. So this is the basic thing. This is in our hand. Unfortunately, the managing the hospital and medical infrastructure of the country is not in our hand. But the such basic thing that maintaining social distance and keep ourselves hygiene is in our hand. And irrespective of religious and social status, people should understand. And it is the job of the government to run an awareness program. Unfortunately, I don't see any kind of awareness program right now in India. And I don't see government interested to do such kind of thing. They should run an awareness program. They should publish in local magazine, local newspaper. Every day they should publish advertisement in local languages that what we common citizen can do to prevent the disease. Because prevention is better, the best cure right now. Because if you fall sick, you would eventually die because you don't have hospital. You don't have any kind of medical access in this country. Unfortunately, there is a disparity between ruling class or the upper class and the lower class in the country right now. Because those people who have any kind of access, still like Twitter, for example, social media is playing a very important role right now. In India, Twitter has become a COVID helpline. But the Twitter is also a thing of privilege. How many people have access to the smartphone and 4G internet or Wi-Fi internet in India? How many people can use Twitter? How many people can speak English? So this is also kind of privilege. Those people who have a smartphone and who can access social media. And even on social media, if you have thousands of followers, your verified account, your voice will be heard easily and as soon as possible. But if you don't have any kind of clout on social media, you do not have access to the politician or the influential people on social media, your voice will not be heard, unfortunately. So we can see that kind of inequality in the society right now. But those people, the common people who can do whatever they are doing their best to provide help. I don't see the government in picture right now. The government is trying to help. The Prime Minister had not addressed any single press conference since the last 7 years. If he had, leave the last 6-7 years, at least it was his duty to address the nation during pandemic. He hasn't done. He was busy in election campaign in West Bengal. So we government is not focusing on us. At least we as a citizen, it's our job and it's our duty to protect ourselves and our family. If we see someone violating the norms of social distancing, COVID rules around us in our mohallas, in our society, maybe it's our duty to remind them, please do not do such kind of things. If you see someone who is not wearing mask, at least ask him to wear a mask properly. If you see someone is not following the norms of social distance, please ask him politely to follow the norms of social distance. That's what we can do right now. And in our personal capacity, we can help people. Like there are families in metro cities, there are entire families COVID positive right now. So what you can do is you can provide them food, you can look after them, whether they are getting any kind of assistance or not. You can say, okay, you need any kind of medical assistance, I can make call for you, I can help you to arrange an ambulance if you need. I can help you to arrange oxygen or medicine, basic medicine. That's what we as a citizen can do. We can't do better than that. We cannot build an entire medical infrastructure overnight. That's the government job. We can we must question our government, what they are doing right now. That's what we can do. Now I come to the next point, what we as a minority faced during this pandemic. Unfortunately, we have faced a lot of things, and the entire vilification or program campaign, a hateful campaign we faced in last 1 year. As a Muslim, I'm speaking from the starting of the march, sorry, from the ending of the march, when the Tablighi Jamaat Nizamuddin Markaz incident came into the limelight last year. Since then, Muslims have faced abuses, humiliation, and physical attack in India. And it goes for few weeks and few months until things become normal. So many people were arrested last year. Police have used brutal forces against the Muslim who were gathered. I understand that everyone is not, they don't have common sense in India. So the people do not understand, especially those people who don't have that kind of knowledge, and out of ignorance, they flouted the norms of social distancing in small villages. So people, the police went there and used the brutal force, lathi charge on them, booked them, arrested them under draconian charges. So many people spent many months and weeks behind the bar because of that. And most of them, I don't need to mention their religion and caste, who were there. They were Muslim and other vulnerable people in the section of the society. Indian High Court, so many high courts from the different state of India have, like, for example, I would cite the example of the Bombay High Court. They categorically say the member of Tablighi Jamaat were made scapegoat by the Indian media. They were not at fault at all. It was not their mistake. But who will return back the days they spent behind the bar without committing any kind of crime? They were not at fault. So it was an entire plan to divert the attention from the incompetency of the government. And this just shifted the blame from government to the Muslim. And Muslim are the easier target in the India right now. The same thing happening in India again. Recently, Tejaswi Surya, he is a parliamentarian of the BJP from the South Bengaluru. What he did was, when Bengaluru and Karnataka state, they are facing a lot of problem right now. They cannot control pandemic there. And BJP is the ruling party there. They were facing criticism because of their mishandling of COVID-19 situation in Bangalore, in Karnataka. What he did was, he just read out 17 names in media, in the presence of the media. Those people, those 17, they all belong to the Muslim community, and they were working in the COVID war room, which was set up by the Bangalore Municipal Corporation. So Bangalore Municipal Corporation has set up a call center type of COVID war room, where 205 employees work. Every day they receive so many calls from the COVID patient. They provide them information regarding the COVID bed, COVID hospital, etc. So out of the 205 employees, he cherry-picked 17 names, and he and a few other legislators who belong to the BJP, they addressed, they went to the COVID war room, and in the presence of media, Tejaswi Surya, who is the parliamentarian of the BJP, read out those 17 names, all belong to the Muslim community, and they said how you recruited them, what their qualification, and other legislator, MLA of the BJP has said, are you running a COVID war room or you are running a madrasa? So what happened after this incident? The name of the 16 Muslims were circulating in the social media, Facebook, WhatsApp, and everywhere. They were called terrorists. The message was circulating like, these 17 people are the terrorists, belong to a certain community, and they are responsible for the death of the Hindu patients in Bangalore. Those 16 people were sacked immediately from their job for committing no mistake. I mean, what's their fault? They have not committed any kind of crime. The person who have accused of committing any kind of crime couldn't utter a word, single word, that they have done any kind of mistake. Just because of their religious identity, they were attacked. Although Muslims have done so many things in last few weeks in this country, from providing oxygen and medicine to performing the last rites of those Hindus who were abandoned by their own family. So this is what we are facing right now. Whether we do good or bad, we have to face. Unfortunately, they are not fringe elements who are targeting us. They are the one who are the mainstream. A person who belongs to the ruling party and who is a member of parliament, you cannot call him fringe. So this kind of attack on the Muslim is an organized way, and I would say state-sponsored. If a member of the parliament attacking us, then it's a state-sponsored attack. Now I would come on third point, what is the role of the majority? Nobody wants to discuss that actually. But I would say the role of the majority is most crucial. Because you see, in a society, when it is not equal for everyone, where majority has more say in the democracy or in the system, when they have more share in the system, when they have more power in the system, so they have greater responsibility. They have more power, of course, they have greater responsibility. And I can say with great responsibility, when it comes to the following the government rule and instruction, minority, not only India, but anywhere in the Southeast Asia, they follow it with more passion, because they know if anyhow they violate any rules of the government, they will face the crackdown by the government. The security forces and police will harass them, and they will be booked and they will be arrested immediately. So those people who are already vulnerable, marginalized, the fear of the government, they try their best to follow the rules and regulation cited by the government. When it comes about the majority, they are high on the majority. Unko nasha hai majority ka. They don't listen to the government at all. Yes. And the recent example is the COVID, the Kumbh Mela, which was organized in the Uttarakhand, Haridwar. So it was not only the society, majority society, which supported that congregation, religious congregation. The government itself, whether it's state government, whether it's central government, they supported the entire religious congregation. They knew that right now India is going through worst phase of the COVID pandemic. We have not ended the pandemic yet. Still, they published so many advertisements on front news of the local newspaper, national newspaper. There were advertisement in television, and they were inviting people. So millions of people gathered there. What Muslims faced last year for unintentionally organizing a small congregation in the Nizamuddin Markaz, there to before 15 March, the majority community has not faced the same kind of outrage, and they are still not facing. What BJP, a ruling party, have done during the pandemic, they have conducted so many election rallies in Bengal and other various states of the India. They have not faced that kind of outrage. Nobody called them name, nobody blamed them, nobody called them corona bomb, nobody accused them of spreading corona jihad or bioterrorism in the country right now. So they have that kind of privilege, and they have always misused that privilege. Unfortunately, they have misused that privilege. They have not taken any kind of responsibility on their shoulder. It's onus is on their shoulder too. If you are privileged, you are in the majority, you have support of the system, then you need to fulfill your responsibility towards the society. Unfortunately, they haven't done. Recently, just 2 days back in the Gujarat, I think there is a city, Sanand, in Gujarat. A huge religious congregation has taken place there, and they all belong to the majority community. Of course, it was highlighted in the social media and media, but again, the entire society will not take blame for that. Nobody would vilify the entire society. That's your privilege you have because of your Hindu identity or the majority identity. And nobody addressed that, unfortunately. This should be addressed. People should talk about this kind of discrimination as well. When one person who belongs to minority community commit any kind of mistake, you blame the entire society and their community. And when a community collectively commit a mistake, you do not blame that community, or you don't blame a single person for that. Thank you so much.
I truly agreed with you. Thank you so much for sharing your views. Our last speaker, Dr. Abhay Kumar, he's a writer, journalist, and social activist, belongs to India. Thank you so much for joining us. I hope everything is well there. May you proceed now.
Thank you very much for giving me this invitation. I think the previous speaker, brother Asif Khan, has spoken very important things, and he has said many problems related to India, and his focus was on the Muslim minority, how they have been demonized, and the government continues to support such kind of demonization. I must say that this has been a very, very tough time for all of us. I am at present I am staying in a room, in a single room near Jawaharlal Nehru University in New Delhi, and the situations in Delhi is so dreadful that we fear stepping out of our home. Our hospitals are not able to provide sufficient amount of oxygen, and even in national capital, people are dying because of lack of medical facilities. Friends, it has been very, very tough time when we open our Facebook account, when we go through the post. I think every second or third post is about somebody crying for oxygen, somebody crying for medicine, somebody crying for getting a bed, and then ultimately somebody gives this information that his or her close relatives have passed away. This is creating very, very traumatic situations, and friends are advising me that I should not go to any social site media. I should keep myself away from news and newspaper. But sometimes I think that not opening Facebook account or Twitter account or not reading any newspaper is not the solution. We have to face the reality. Friends, this semester I was teaching a course in Delhi University, and I was teaching a paper by a well-known a scholar of India's foreign policy. His name is Harsh Pant, and he recently wrote a book on India's foreign policy. And at one place, he said that there has been an expectation that India by 2020 will become a bigger economy than the USA. When I am reading Harsh Pant that prediction that India will become superpower and maybe the big bigger GDP than the United States of America by 2040 or 50, I think that big lie than this statement. At a time when scholars and intellectuals who are sponsored by a state and corporate who are projecting India to be a superpower and who are celebrating the rise of India as a citizen of India, I am saying that we are not getting much facility from our government at this corona pandemic. Friends, brother Asif Khan had said rightly that last year Tablighi Jamaat was demonized, and media launched a campaign, vicious campaign against the minority, and media coined terms like Corona Jihad, Tablighi Jihadi, something like that. And even Hindi newspaper carried false stories that those Muslims who are Tablighi Jamaat members who are getting treatment because they are corona positive, they are not cooperating with doctors and nurses. They are fighting with them. They are abusing them. They are even asking masaledar biryani. So you can understand Muslim, corona positive, fighter, then unruly, then threat for the society, then misbehaving with nurses and doctors, and then finally asking biryani. That is masaledar biryani. You could understand. As if that Muslim do not eat anything other than the biryani. I know many friends who say, I know one of my friends, and I cook very well. And when I ask him that, chicken banai, mutton banai, then he says, nahi. No chicken, mutton. You cook sada dal or hari sabzi and chutney, something like that. I like this because now I am growing old and I don't like this meat any longer. Once in a while is okay. After one week or 15 days, it is okay. So there are Muslims who are fond of meat. There are Muslims who are not very fond of meat. There are Hindus who are fond of meat. There are Hindus who do not like meat. So to say that one community is only asking for masaledar biryani, that is very, very vicious campaign. I myself like so much masaledar biryani. I like masaledar biryani. I am not a Muslim. So that campaign was being launched, and I must say that at that time also, I wrote article against that propaganda. I wrote in Dawat, I wrote in Countercurrent, I wrote in so many other places, and I even made videos. They are all available there. And I started refuting those claims by the very time when such charges were being made. And I remember it that I stay very much near Jawaharlal Nehru University, JNU. After doing my PhD, I have taken one room outside, a rented room. So one day I was just walking last year, and then one of the mess staff in JNU had just said, "Kaise hain aap? How are you from the distance?" I said, "Ab main theek hu, I'm also fine. How are you?" Then he said that government has almost controlled corona pandemic, but it is the Tablighi who have just spoiled the game, and they are now spreading that corona pandemic. I must say that I didn't know that the police has gone and they have raided the houses of the central office of Tablighi Jamaat in Nizamuddin, where the tomb or the mazar of the great Sufi Nizamuddin Aulia is located. So they have gone there, and I didn't know it. I was told by the person who is working in a mess, the person who cooks food. So you could understand that how media played negative role at that time, that a person who is educated, who is a journalist, is unaware that the raid has been made, and now the corona is being spread by Tablighi. Before me, sabji wala, chai wala, mess mein kaam karne wala, very common people were told by this propagandist media, and they were telling me. Then I went to buy vegetable, and the discussion at the vegetable shop was going on. Tablighi logon ne khel kharab kar diya, Bharat ko piche kar diya, sarkar ko pareshan kar diya. Tablighi Jamaat organization, a Muslim organizations of the Muslims who are talking about reforming society and preaching the very basics of the Islam, they were made responsible scapegoat. And I must say that not only the right-wing people, a section of progressive people, I don't understand that they were also carried away. I don't know whether they were ignorant, they were innocent, or they also wanted to join Hindutva bandwagon. They also wrote they also criticized Muslims community. And many of them, interestingly, many of them were Muslims. They did it because they think that if they criticize Muslims community, they will become more progressive. And I had a heated discussion with a Delhi University professor who is a progressive person, who is a member of left, good person, good human being. But he wrote, he blamed Tablighi Jamaat, and I criticized him. He didn't answer me. I don't know whether he want to uphold that article which he wrote after the Delhi, after the several high courts have said that, and as our brother Asif has made that Bombay High Court said that it was made a scapegoat. So at that time, the attack was on the minority. And also, I must say, I never say that in India, the problem is only being faced by Muslims minority. This is not correct. I think this is my view, that the problem is really faced by mazdoor. They are faced by kamgar. They are faced by the workers. And Muslims are mazdoor. Muslims are workers. Dalits are workers. That reality should not be forgotten. And one thing I must say, that as far as identity is concerned, they are very important thing. But identity was to be studied in context of division of labor, What is it that earlier when the society was living in a commune and when the property was accumulated and when the classes started developing, the rich and the poor started, the two categories started evolving. At that time, people were divided on the basis of occupation. What people are doing. For example, if somebody is into, let's say, chamde ka kaam, leather work, they were called Dalits. If somebody is doing puja, that was doing priestly work, they became Brahmins. So the occupation is very important. So the caste system must be criticized. Caste system must be demolished. Caste system is a sin, I must say. Caste system is an ugly thing, I must acknowledge. India's progress is being stopped by the caste system. But we have to also keep in mind that the talk of caste is not complete until and unless we also challenge division of labor. Why somebody is working as a, let's say, as a sanitation worker who are not being paid, and I being Babu and I being a rich person, I'm having all the fun. I'm having all the facilities. If somebody comes to my house, if he cooks my food, he will be waiting for me to give food. He cannot take food and eat first. The person who has made the food cannot eat first. The person who has painted my wall, the person who has made my house cannot live in that house. The man who has made Juta's shoes, that person cannot wear Adidas shoe. So this reality is very, this stark reality is very, very important. And this is why the reality of Pakistan, the reality of Bangladesh, the reality of, let's say, India, the reality of Nepal, they all get connected. The situation in India, the situation in Pakistan may be a bit different. It may be possible that in India, now the situation is very, very worse. Maybe that in Pakistan, it may not be so worse. But Pakistan is not a Jannat and India is not a hell. That we should never understand, never think. Similarly, our countrymen, most of them, through propaganda of media, they think that Pakistan is hell and India is Jannat, India is paradise. That is wrong. And I must tell you that in my media, if the potato and tomato price in your country goes up, it becomes a big news. So one day I was thinking, ki, yaar, potato and tomato to mere desh mein bhi badh raha hai. Matlab, tomato, the price of tomato is also increasing in India. The price of diesel and petrol is being increased. The price of gas cylinder is increasing. I remember when I was doing my MPhil and PhD some 5, 6, 7 years back, when this government was not there, the cylinder, one gas cylinder was being sold at 500 rupees. And then we used to get subsidy also. But what has happened? They have come and the new government has increased this to 1,000 rupees. They played a fraud that, okay, you first pay the money and then your subsidy will be returned. But now the subsidy is not coming to your bank account. So from 500 to 1,000. That is not the news in India. In Pakistan, what has happened? Tomato ka price bad gaya. Tomato price has gone up. That has become the news. Okay. Onion price have increased in India. That is not the news. Because if you say that onion price has gone up, you have to hold your government responsible. That government is funding you. That government is helping you. That government is giving you money. Or that government is has produced that kind of media. So they will not touch it. I remember it. Last year it was said that corona ki maut marega Pakistan. Okay. Corona ki maut marega Pakistan. So which means that Pakistan will die the death of corona. Last year, some media, some right-wing media, they were carrying that story. Now we are dying. We are dying. And Pakistani people, our brothers, they are praying for our shifa, our recovery. They are praying for normalcy to be restored. They are praying for us. So see what is the reality and what is the case. We, our media, they have never thought for a while that they should not, even if Pakistan is struggling to fight corona, we should never run that story that corona ki maut marega Pakistan. Pakistan will die the death of corona. See, India, in Indian ruling establishment are saying that it is big democracy. But they have never thought for a while that why they are doing like this. They should behave as a responsible country. They should lead by example. But what we are doing, we are not people of India. So please, my brother from across the border, do not, please make a difference. Please differentiate people of India and ruling class of India. People of India are always with you. They do not want to fight with you. I love to come to Lahore. I don't know when that dream will be realized. I know that Lahore at one time was the center of Hindi or Urdu cinema or Hindustani cinema. And people say that Amritsar and Lahore is not different. Then Karachi is also a very good city. Similarly, you also want to visit Lal Qila. You also want to visit Qutub Minar. You also want to visit the Dargah of Nizamuddin Awliya. You also want to go to Nizamuddin Chisti's Dargah in Fatehpur Sikri. You also want to see Fatehpur Sikri's fort. You also want to go to Ajmer. So Indians and Pakistanis are brother. People never wanted to fight it. It is the politicians who out of their own interest created and divided the country. That is a different thing. I don't want to talk about here. It is a matter of history. Some other day we'll take up this issue. So I was just saying that the questions of mazdoor and the question of workers is very important. And last time, the migrant workers who come to Delhi, who work in big city, they come from rural area. They were not given any relief. Even they were not given transport facility. They were left to their fate, and they walked back to their home, and they covered thousands of kilometers. Most of them had to suffer. Some of them died on their way, and most unfortunately, a number of Adivasi, the tribal workers, they were coming from western state of India, I think Maharashtra. They were going back to their state. If I'm correct, they were going back to Chhattisgarh. And on the way, they were tired and they had some food and some roti, the dry roti. And they slept on the railway track, because at that time, railway was not running. But unfortunately, the train came and the train crushed them, killed them, cut them into the pieces. and several, I think 10 or 15 mazdoor died. Nobody gave, the government did not take any note to that. And people started suffering. The people continued suffering. So this was the reality, that people are suffering, mazdoors are suffering. No state protection is given. And India, on the other hand, in the book, in the foreign policy book, in the international relations book, India is being projected as the fourth large economy, I think third large economy or fourth large economy or fifth large economy, a emerging power. And by 2020, the prediction is being made that it will become the bigger, it will become bigger economy than the USA. I don't know. I want to break my head with a stone here, that how could a country which is not able to provide oxygen that can be made out of a plant, that plant can be installed by spending a few crore rupees. I'm telling you, in Delhi, in my locality, rich people, they spend crore on their marriage. Crore. One rally by the ruling party, I don't think they spent less than crore on the rally. They spent more than crore on a rally. So they are not willing to pay a few crore rupees to set up a plant of oxygen that could make oxygen, that could produce oxygen, that could save the life of so many people. And I must tell you, my friends are telling that more than corona pandemic, it is the mismanagement, it is the failure of the health facility, it is privatization of the health facility, it is lack of supply, medicine, oxygen, that people are dying. Corona is not a Satan. Corona is not Jamraj, that the god of death, that it has come and anyhow it will take your life. It is not going to happen. If somebody is given all the facilities, somebody is given all the treatment, I think 80% people does not need any treatment. Now 10% people need very, very little treatment. Now out of them, 5 to 6% people need some serious treatment. 1% people will become serious, or maybe less than 1% people have a threat of life. And even if that medical facility is there, we can reduce the death rate to 0.0001%. We can do it, but there is no willpower. There is no willpower. It is sad. I do not know that whether our ruling elites have become robot, whether they carry pathar ka dil, sang dil, a heart made of a stone. I don't know. गालिब है से दिल है कि ही वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट कि संग दिल एंड एंड पत्थर का दिल, कि दिल पत्थर का तो नहीं है, दिल ये दिल पत्थर का तो नहीं है, वो तो रोएगा ही रोएगा, इट विल क्राई, द हार्ट इज नॉट मेड ऑफ पत्थर, दिल ही तो है न संग खेस, दर्द से भर न जाए क्यों, समथिंग लाइक दैट ही सेड. So, but our rulers, I think Ghalib was wrong at that time. Our rulers at that time, they carry pathar ka dil. They will never cry. They will never cry. They will never cry. And I am telling you, please, please do not think that this is the situation of India only. This is worldwide situation. Since India has got a huge population, so the problem is more exposed here. The problem is here, they are unable to control it. But one thing you have to keep in mind, that a person who does not have money cannot be deprived of health facility, because right to life is fundamental human right. Right to employment, right to work, right to education. These should be made human rights. These should be made fundamental rights. It should not be privatized. A person who is born in a slum must have all the facilities related to health, public health, that a rich person has. Even and a person should not be tolerated, should not be allowed to stay in Jhuggi. Jhuggi should be removed. A decent living is very much important. And I think this is also the basic teachings of religion, the basic teachings of religion. So on this point, if people can come together, okay, let's have other differences, but here we should have no disagreement that people across the globe should have right to life, should have health, education, employment free. It should not be privatized. And not only that, we should also think about opening our border. If people are ill, if people are not well, I think borders should be opened immediately. No visa should be required. That bureaucratic hurdles should be removed, and one country should facilitate the treatment for the another country. That should be our spirit. That should be our spirit. This platform should not be a place to feel proud Indian or to feel proud Pakistani or to feel proud Bangladeshi. We should feel proud human being. We should feel proud human being. And our life, the life of human being, cannot be in harmony if we are not maintaining harmony with nature and with other creatures. The old modernist dream that we will control the nature, that is not going to work. I think we must think about living a very simple life, and we should think about other persons also. If you are running, if you are carrying, let's say, AC, you should think about how many people are being deprived of basic lamp or a small fan. So the AC can be removed. I am not saying that AC cannot be removed. If our house is made in such a way, if plants are there around your surrounding, I don't think that AC, without AC, we cannot live. So environmental protection is also important. And we should get out of this seat of, hyper-nationalism. This curse, I must say, this curse of hyper-nationalism. The cases in India is rising, but nobody knows what will happen tomorrow across the border. So the time is to stand in solidarity, but such feeling is not there in our leaders. I must say that when the corona pandemic is here, when people are locked in their room, what the ruling classes are doing in my country? In India, they are making another parliament that is not needed. Parliament does not protect democracy. Vibrant democracy is one where people's concerns are being debated, discussed, and that is transformed into policies. These people, I think, these Sangdil people, they think that if you have great parliament, if they copy White House model, if they make their parliament on the model of House White House, they will become superpower. Shame on them. Our ruling classes in our country, they are spending thousands of crore on making this new parliament. And this parliament is being constructed at this moment. It has not stopped. The government has given clear instructions that even in this this pandemic, the work must continue, and it is an emergency work. But the same amount, if that amount would have been spent on building new hospitals, increasing medical facilities, supplying oxygen, many more lives would have been saved. But this is not their concern. Last year, I also wrote it. I also opposed it in the middle of corona pandemic when the lockdown was being when people were still following corona guidelines. Our great leader, the top leader, went to Ayodhya. He did Bhumi Pujan there, and the Ram temple started building. Please think for a while that does Lord Ram need a house when his own bhakt, his own devotees, they have no house? Tell me. The Ayodhya movement was a political. People worship Ram in India. Many people worship Ram in India. But they do not need Ayodhya. They do not need Ayodhya. Okay, you can make temple, no problem. You make temple. Temples have been made for so many years, for the thousands of years. But priority is there. You have to make priority. I don't know. I am not a scholar of religion, but I want to tell you that if you have got 1 lakh rupees for and if you want to use that amount, 1 lakh rupees amount, to go to, let's say, yatra, any yatra, or if you want to go to Hajj, and if you find somebody, a human being who is ill, who does not have money, and if you postponed your yatra, if you postponed your safar to Hajj or maybe Vaishno Devi or any or Ayodhya or Kasi or Mathura or Banaras, and if you spend that money for the treatment of the person, and if you help that poor person, I think God will be more happy than if you see that person, you become Sangdil, you become Pathar Ka Dil, you close your eye, and then you go there and you think that you have done great. So the worship of God cannot be done without serving humanity. So this is my note. I am not here to criticize one country and praise another country. I have told the reality in India. It is very, very worse. I am in my room and I joined late because I have no sense of time. I was awake till late night. So situation is very horrible. If this is situations in Delhi, think about rural area, what is happening there. Just pray for India, just pray for humanity that they get well. And now this corona pandemic should be over, and health and education, employment, these should be the part of human rights. This should be given to everybody. They should be accessible to all. And we should get out of this passion of my country is great and my country is the best. We should think humanity is the best. And those people who are talking about that India will become superpower by 2040 and it will become bigger economy, I just want them to say what they have to say when people are dying out of oxygen in Delhi's hospital, where you in the same city where you live and the same city where the prime minister is living, the same city where president is living. Are they not aware of the fact? But government is busy with managing perception. Even if situation is worse there, in TV, in media, things should appear rosy. So if you are a scholar or if you are an activist, if you are a journalist and you are writing the truth, a letter will come from the police, a letter will come from the government, and you will be threatened. Do not write like this. The news is coming from the Uttar Pradesh, the most populated state of India, that the government has given, I don't know, written or unwritten circular, it is some kind of a threat, that oxygen shortage should not be told to media. And even at the cremation ground, journalists are being stopped from going there and recording there. So instead of addressing the issue, they are trying to curb news. They are trying to stop news. This is very bad situations in India. I just thank you for giving me this opportunity to say my feeling. And please pray for India. Please stand with India. And this situation is not only happening in India. We must not forget that even the mighty state of the United States has also seen so many deaths. So yes, I am winding up. It's a global pandemic. It is a global pandemic. Let's work together. And we should not feel proud. We should not think, okay, India has led the fight against the corona pandemic. we will give medicine to everybody. That is all a stupid. Unless humanity work together, unless they work as a team, it will never be defeated. The corona will never be defeated. And one thing I want to request you, that any kind of patent law, any kind of upholding drug, any kind of kala bazari, black marketing, and thinking about earning profit at this time is against humanity. Thank you very much for joining.
Appreciate your informative words. Thank you so much. Some participants have few questions regarding the topic. Dear participants, you are allowed to ask now.
I want to ask a question from Mr. Asif. Sir, my question is, as you know, in India, minorities are helping in time of pandemic, but you really think that Indian majority groups will help them after the pandemic against violence and discrimination?
We, the Muslim community, has been doing this kind of humanitarian work to not please the community or to not get any kind of certificate of good Muslim or the patriotic Muslim. I think they are doing it because they do understand it is the best thing to do as a human being, to serve other people, to help other people in this crisis of humanity, first thing. So I, as a Muslim, I don't expect any kind of any good thing. And I do not expect that there will be a change at their heart in the majority regarding the Muslim. Because whatever is in their heart right now, I'm talking about the Hindu majority of India, it is a process of many decades. They do not become a zombie or a hateful fascist overnight, that you are a good person today and you sleep in the night and when you woke up next morning, you will be a fascist. That's not how things work. It is the work of many decades and many years. The people have been brainwashed for many years through various different kind of propaganda. So you see, they are not going to change. And if you want them to change, the majority of India want to change, they need a social reform. And the onus of the social reform is on the shoulder of the majority, not on the minority. We cannot reform them. How will we reform? We are already vulnerable people. We are showing that good gesture of humanity just because we need to do as a good human being. But expecting that just because we are doing some kind of good thing, the result in the decrease the number of the mob lynching and communal violence, I don't see that that could be reduced. They won't reduce in the country. And those people who belong to the majority community, I don't know who was the questioner, if they belong to majority community, it is their job to reform their own circle first. If you see that the person in your family member, your close relative, they are the one who spread hatred against the minority. They are the one who are practicing Islamophobia, casteism, or any kind of other form of racism, then it's your job to reform them. It's your job to stop them. It's your job to explain them why they are wrong, why whatever they are doing is contributing in racism, hatred, and they are intentionally or unintentionally, they are dehumanizing a section of the particular society. So it is the onus on the majority society. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now, another question is there.
Hello, everyone. I would like to ask Ms. Dr. Sujanya. The question is that what mechanisms are most important and effective in the collective social responsibility for combating COVID-19?
Yeah. See, firstly, it's a very complicated situation because our structures are extremely complicated. The kind of inequalities that are persistent, I would also like to partially answer the earlier question that Hindu majorities or Hindu community is a community which is actually not a community. Okay, so when you say Hindu, who is a Hindu? In Hinduism, there are 3,000 castes and 2,500 subcastes. So the idea of four castes of Brahmin, Kshatriya, Vaishya, and the Shudra is only a Varna system, which was used as an ideologically and as an idea used by the colonial government for its own, you know, easier mechanism to rule the country. But there are so many divisions within the Hindu community. So actually, the Hindu majorities are actual minorities. The top tiers of the society, being the dominant caste and Brahmin, is a minority section. Whereas the large number of lower castes and Dalits actually are a huge chunk within the Hindu community. Okay, so with this kind of very structurally complex society, which produced enormous number of inequalities in the society, say the question of minorities, the question of gender minorities, the question of also Dalits and Adivasis, has posed a very difficult scenario in the pandemic situation. What is reflecting, earlier our friend Chandraya Gopani also mentioned that what reflected in the pandemic is what existed prior to the pandemic. Okay, so the inequalities and the kind of situation that we face and we see today in the pandemic is exactly what happened in the prior to the pandemic. The communal hatred against the Muslims, against the Christians, against other minorities, and the caste atrocities against Dalits, they have only doubled, okay, because pandemic has given a situation. But when the situation was normal as well, there was no interference of the state to work towards the betterment of the whole society and reducing the disparities among the communities in India or even other societies like South Asian societies. So the question here is, what is the best way? Is to it cannot be a single isolated act of intervention, but it has to be a continuous process towards which we have to work towards the empathy and mutuality, towards bringing empathy and mutuality and the within the communities within India or the South Asian societies. But at the larger level, it's also state's responsibility. Today, what you see is a state which is a government which is fascist in nature, as well as capitalist in its interventions with the other countries in the globe. So therefore, one, the state within the people of India, okay, I am here very skeptically using the term people of India and not citizens of India, because prior to the pandemic, what we have witnessed was that the state, the government wanted to declare, has actually declared that not all the citizens of India are citizens of this country, but only partial citizens of the country or not even the citizens of the country. So it has invested that much of energy into the CAA. So the kind of CAA protests, the kind of situation that existed prior to the pandemic only showed the communal hatred that existed prior to the pandemic, which resulted into the prejudices and the propaganda of Sangh Parivar, which led to the atrocities and attacks on Muslim minorities. So similarly, caste system, as Chandraya was rightly speaking, caste system is the most important factor within the Indian society, where you cannot imagine any aspect of a human life in India without caste system. Okay, so every part of it, like everydayness of the caste, which is resulted in the pandemic situation, where the violence against Dalits, the negligence against Dalits, and the question of these, the whole lot of the communities that traveled, that walked towards their homes, the migrant laborers, they were also Dalits and largely lower caste. That entire population may not be the dominant caste Hindu community. So the intervention should be at the level of altering these structures, working upon deconstructing these structures, structures of communalism, structures of casteism, structures of patriarchy, and structures of heteronormativity. And that is the entire, it should take up a space of a longer process than the immediate response. Okay, so during COVID-19, the state and the people should be responsible to understand the issues of those who are insignificant groups for the state. Okay, so trans women become insignificant, Adivasis become insignificant, Muslims become insignificant for the state. Okay, so those neglected minorities, neglected vulnerable communities should be reached out by the people, by the activists, by the people's movements. Otherwise, the state is only going to give you that there are no vulnerable groups, there are no deaths of migrant laborers that took place in the first wave of pandemic and the lockdown. But what are these images that we are getting, where a toddler was actually trying to wake up the dead mother in northern parts of India? And also we have examples of the pandemic times where people, like as Abhay Kumar sir was talking about, the Madhya Pradesh, Aurangabad, the train accident where people were sleeping on the railway track, and who got crushed by 16 people who got crushed by the train. So how could the government so easily say there was no death toll of the people who were traveling back home, migrant laborers? Because the state now is an authoritarian state. It's also fascist in nature, casteist in nature, and fundamentalist in nature, that it is not going to take care of the lower tiers of the society. So therefore, it is important to reach out to those communities which are negligible according to the government.
Thank you. Finally, I would like to invite Dr. Khurram to conclude this webinar. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Kisa. It's a great privilege for us to be joined by such a knowledgeable panel. And I would like to express my sincere gratitude to the eminent speakers, Dr. Sardisha Priya S. Vijetunge, Dr. Saujanya Tamala Pakula, Dr. Chandriya Gopani, Dr. Abhay Kumar, and Mr. Muhammad Asif Khan, for exploring a wide spectrum of perspective, experiences, and expertise. The COVID-19 pandemic is a major global health emergency. Since the epidemic necessitates large-scale behavioral changes and puts considerable psychological strains on people, the social and behavioral sciences insights can be used to better align human behavior with epidemiologists and public health experts' recommendations. To prepare the population for a potential future reemergence of the epidemic, capacity building and community cohesions are necessary. As a diverse community, South Asians should be divided into categories based on the available evidence. The proportion of minorities varies depending on the population and health situation. So it is critical to improve the capacity for understanding the transmission, outbreak evaluation, risk communication, and assessment of cascading impact on vital and other services. South Asian population are less to report the mental health harassment. However, the economic deprivation, inequality, and the burden of comorbidity would undoubtedly have a negative impact on this minority group's mental health. Stress level, as well as anxiety and other mental health problems, are also thought to rise during the lockdown period. So here are some policy recommendations to be implemented. The COVID-19 shown people extending charitable assistance to those who are struggling the most. So we need to promote more neighbor-to-neighbor cooperation in this regard. During this crucial period, an additional user-friendly and culturally relevant app connected to other social media platforms could be helpful. Prioritization of community-level preparedness and contingency plans for recognizing suspicious cases, isolating and/or quarantining them, gaining access to healthcare, and securing jobs or financial assistance are the key areas. Every minority community has its own distinct culture, and group confidence and empowerment would be enhanced if they adopted their own culture and background. People are perplexed by the new pandemic, and government and community trust must be earned. Misinformation and fake news, which arise as a result of difficult to understand innovations that have now spread. Any group can easily skewed and misled by hawks. As a result, there is a need for a better ethnicity specific knowledge flow between the public health system and the population. To improve community social cohesion, a network of networks could be implemented. So given the time constraint here, I would like to close the session. Thanks to all of the speakers once again. Sarim looks forward for your ongoing support for the rights of minorities in South Asia. May God bless us all with more love, more peace, and more light.
Thank you so much. On the behalf of the organization, I would like to express my gratitude to all of you. It has been an honor to listen to such a talented individuals. Thank you so much. Thank you for your patience. I wish you all a very good evening. Goodbye and stay safe.